Well, I'd like to welcome you all again. I'm Jeremy Kinney, your expert for today. I'm a curator in the Aeronautics Division of the National Air and Space Museum. I'm going to be talking about the first world flight from 1924 today in the Pioneers of Flight Gallery. As many of you know, Pioneers of Flight is a new reinterpretation of a long-standing gallery in the building. And you can see we still have some construction there going on in the back, so come back November, the week of November 19th, more or less, and you'll see everything. But I'm here today to talk about this particular airplane and its crew. This is a Douglas World Cruiser. It's named the Chicago, and it was flown by two Army Air Service pilots, Lieutenants Lowell Smith and Leslie Arnold, in 1924, in what was called the Army Air Service Around the World Flight, or the World Flight. And why it's in the Pioneers of Flight Gallery, of course, it's a first, the first flight around the world. Now, this isn't nonstop. They start in April, they end in September. It's 175 days. It's about 27 stops total. They fly about 27,000 miles around the Earth. And it's intended first as a flight of four aircraft, numbered 1, 2, 3, 4. See, and they're named after major American cities, Seattle, Chicago, Boston, and New Orleans. And two aircraft, Chicago, you see here, and New Orleans make it around the world. The purpose of this flight is within the broader framework of military aviation in the 1920s and 30s, but also in the overall framework of aviation during this pioneering period, in which enthusiastic individuals, we use the term air-minded, it is a contemporary term, the belief in aviation, the airplane bringing up about a better world. Well, military aviators were air-minded. And they saw the airplane as a key not only for extending their own importance within the defense establishment of the United States, other nations, especially in Europe, but as a way to make the world better. So Mason Patrick, the chief of the Army Air Service, and you know, we all know that's the Air Force today, he saw this as a way to prove the capability of the airplane as a global technology. And for the military, that means moving stuff that blows things up, kills people, and people who do the same thing around the world in a global capacity. But it also shows the ability of the airplane to be, once again, a global technology, flying around the world. And language such as compressing time and space and distance, those are what contemporaries are saying about the airplane. And it's the military that pioneers that in the early 1920s. In many ways, that's because of the cost of the technology. That who else can afford aircraft that can fly around the world, fly high speed, fly altitude, or fly long periods of time over particular terrain. So that's the big picture. These military flights of spectacle that you fly around the world, you achieve a first, but you prove your point about the capability of military technology as well as the capability of the airplane. This particular flight, the Around the World flight, is in a string of activities that especially the American Army Air Service are engaged in. Above you is the Fokker T-2. That's the first aircraft to fly across the United States nonstop. That's May of 1923. The next round in these long distance flights is this Around the World flight that's going to take place in 1924. Four crews are selected, four aircraft, for about, I think it's $100,000, about $20,000 a piece. You get four world cruisers and a prototype. This particular airplane is built by the Douglas Aircraft Company. That is a name that most people recognize that know something about aviation. Donald A. Douglas is one of the first graduates of an aeronautical engineering degree program at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. He goes into business himself after working for pioneer aviator Glenn Martin. And designs a very successful series of single-engine torpedo planes for the U.S. Navy. Well, when the Army Air Service officers want to build an airplane that's rugged, they need to fly around the world, the first thing they recognize is the airplane has to be able to fly off of water and of land. This is the land plane configuration. You see the wheels and the tail skid. This airplane, if you look at the images on these panels, you'll see the Chicago and its other and the other aircraft in the flight on floats so they can operate on land and water. So we have several float planes, two float planes in this gallery. So this is a true aircraft that can fly off both land and water after a simple conversion. The DT-2 torpedo bomber that Douglas produces is a very rugged airplane. It's designed for flying on the water off of the first aircraft carriers. And so it's a rugged structure that's adapted by one of the actual World Flight members. He's one of the chief designers, Erik Nelson. He flies the New Orleans. They adapt this for use by the Army. It's powered by a standard Army Air Service power plant, the Liberty V-12 engine. That's a carryover from World War I, so it's a known technology. It has a large wooden fixed-pitch propeller. We all recognize that. It has a tubular steel fuselage like military aircraft from the Germans from World War I. But this is a large fabric-covered stick and wire, wire-braced airplane. So it's very conventional, but it's very rugged, and it's capable of flying long distances. This is the aircraft they choose. We have the Chicago because after the flight begins in Seattle, where it starts, the first aircraft is Seattle, they start flying west up through Alaska, across the North Pacific. They make the first airplane flight across the Pacific Ocean in the process. They fly through down to Japan, through to China, French Indochina, through India, across the Near East, through modern day Iraq and Jordan, and through up through Europe, through France, through Great Britain, across the North Atlantic, back to the United States. This is a long journey. Well, along the way, two of the aircraft are lost. Seattle is lost in Alaska. The head of the flight, Major Frederick Martin, and Sergeant Alva Harvey, they crash into a mountainside in Alaska. Number one, Seattle's out of the race. The number two airplane, Chicago, with Lowell Smith as the commander, is now the head of the flight. And Smith and Arnold lead the two other aircraft all across Asia, all across the Middle East, all the way across Europe. And as they're crossing the North Atlantic, they lose number three, Boston, commanded by Lee Wade and Hank Ogden. And pretty much if you're an odd-numbered airplane in the world flight, you have bad luck. Boston's lost. And number two, Chicago, number four, New Orleans, they continue on. As the two remaining aircraft return to the United States, they're joined by Boston II, flown by Wade and Ogden, and they rejoin them for the rest of the flight. Martin and Harvey are kind of left by the wayside, kind of forgotten, but Wade and Ogden are included as complete full-fledged members of this world flight, even though their airplane didn't make it. As the world flight passes through, especially Europe and especially the United States, these aviators become those celebrities that we all know that starts with the Wright brothers. We really know it becomes intensified with Lindbergh. We have all these other famous personalities that you learn about in this gallery, such as, you know, the Lindberghs, Emil Earhart, Jimmy Doolittle, here in the back. And so the world flight, these guys are household names for that moment, for that spring, summer, and fall of 1924. And they're welcomed with the adulation of the masses of Europe and the United States, but also in Asia. And their experience is a way to tell a group biography of the pioneer story, of the individuals. So we know about these really famous names, and while we might not know these individuals as well as we do today, they still are major players in the story of pioneering aviation in the 1920s and 30s. And what we were trying to do in reinterpreting this gallery and including the aircraft that are already here, the story of the Chicago is one that tells that story of that reception of the masses to the individuality, the group individuals of the air service, and how they feel about the airplane. And so I hope you stay a little bit afterwards and look into the artifact cases, you'll see remnants of that. This closest case right here that everyone is gathered around, those are personal objects that Lowell Smith, the head of the flight, received as he journeyed through the United States. So there's a famous cartoon that appeared in a newspaper as well as an influential journal. It shows a world cruiser in flight, and it's weighed down by all the medals, the ribbons, the loving cups, the keys to the cities, the commemorative swords that all each of these pilots received. So you'll see things like that. You'll also see some of the equipment that they carried in the world flight. One thing that went along with all of them was a small camera, so they could take pictures of their flight. And we have quite extensive collections of the images taken during the flight, as well as moving picture images. And one thing I'd like to point out is that there's a new artifact in this case. Most of these artifacts we've had for years, The widow of Lowell Smith gave them to us early on. But there's one artifact. You'll see a piece of fabric with a map drawn on it of the North Atlantic with Greenland with a flying boat on it. One thing that most people do not know about the American around the world flight is the fact that other nations in the world were trying to fly around the world at the same time. Italy, Argentina, Portugal, Great Britain all had their around the world flights. And none of them succeeded. They had varying degrees of practical planning. And I'll voice that about the American planning process in a moment. But we have an artifact, a piece of fabric taken from the French flying boat that had foundered in the North Atlantic, was rescued by an American destroyer. And a sailor from that ship took that fabric and drew a map of where they found the airplane, dated it. And that's a record of a sailor commemorating an Italian military flight of spectacle. And that's one of the neat new things that we have for this exhibition. And places the context of the story of this flight within the overall international story of military organizations trying to achieve these firsts and to make their organizations known, but also make the airplane a truly global technology. Lastly, as you look at this airplane, it says Army Air Service World Flight. It's a big green airplane, yellow top. You really can't see that until we get our pylon up. We can look at the airplane from above a little bit at an angle. But we talk about Army, Army, Army. But this was truly in the phrase we would use today is a joint effort between the Army, known as the Air Force, the Navy. They provided ships along the line, as well as the Coast Guard and the Bureau of Fisheries. They provided worldwide support, especially in terms of a supply network, that made this flight possible. So these miniature oil drums and gasoline drums you see around here that are part of the exhibit design have the names of the stops of the fields along the way. You can actually start, I think it's right on another side of this interactive, you can actually go around the world and see some of the stops stenciled along the way. And at every one of the stops, the World Flight had their aviation fuel, they had their oil, they had the support of petroleum companies, especially Mobil Oil as we know them today, is the vacuum oil company. They had all of that support and equipment. And so it was truly a joint effort, as we'd say today, in this flight. So even though it's the Army Air Service World Flight, it's probably the War and Navy different organizations within the U.S. government made this flight possible. I'll stop talking because I like to talk about this a lot, and I'll open up for questions.
Thank you for listening to this edition of Ask an Expert. A companion question and answer session for this lecture may also be available. For a schedule of upcoming Ask an Expert lectures at the museum, please visit www.nasm.si.edu.